Hello and welcome to a special interview with a well-known politician, Subhash Neelaji, who is currently a member of Communist Party of India Marxist. She is the daughter of a freedom fighter, Lakshmi Sehgal ji, who was an officer in Subhash Chandra Bose Azad Hind Fauj. And today, on this Independence Eve, she is going to tell a little bit more about her mother and her contribution in our freedom struggle. Hello, ma'am. So, ma'am, Indian independence movement is seen as a watershed movement in a long Indian history. But as a youngster, we are taught very little about Subhash Chandra Bose's contribution and Lakshmi Sehgal ji's contribution in particular. Can you elaborate a little bit how Lakshmi Sehgal ji contributed and how she met Subhash Chandra Bose ji and how she was as a mother?
You know, it's very difficult to quantify a person's contributions. I'm not going to talk about that. But how she met Subhash Chandra Bose is an interesting story. She, as a doctor, newly qualified doctor, had left Madras and gone to Singapore, and she was practicing medicine there. And that was the time when the British army surrendered to the Japanese, and the British officers abandoned their Indian officers and men, and the Japanese gave them a suggestion to start a army of liberation. And one of the people who was very much for it was someone who later became my father, Prem Sehgal. And the other interesting thing was that he, along with a friend from Madras Medical College who knew my mother, had gone looking for my mother because they needed medical supplies and all that. And they met my mother, and she was also very excited about this army formation, and she was all for it. So they became friendly also. And there were lots of things that happened. They had a lot of, unpleasant experiences in trying to form this army. And finally, Subhash Chandra Bose could come in a submarine from Germany to Tokyo and then to Singapore to assume leadership of the army. And when he had landed in Singapore, by that time, my mother was also very much in touch with some people who belonged to the India Independence League. There were South Indians who had settled in Southeast Asia, and she was friendly with them because her mother was, of course, a congresswoman. And she accompanied three of them to welcome Subhash when he landed in Singapore. And he was happy to meet her also. Anyway, then he went and made a historic speech to the army soldiers saying, "Tum mujhe khoon do, main tumhe azadi dunga." And after that, when he was talking to the IIL people, he said he wanted the Indian community in Southeast Asia to contribute to the army. And he said he was determined to start a women's regiment. So they were very horrified by this. And they said, no, that's not possible. But he said, no, you call that lady doctor that we met. So my mother came and she was very excited by this idea. And she said she would, of course, do whatever was necessary. And he said, when can you join? And she said, tomorrow morning I'll lock up my clinic and I'll come here. And they started the work of recruitment. It's a very inspiring story. And how the very, very ordinary people from ordinary families came to fight for a country that they had never seen, because all these migrants had never known India at all, but still they were so fired by the idea of India and Indian independence. And then the training that they underwent, it was exactly like the men. And then finally they went to the front also, the Jhansi Regiment, Rani of Jhansi Regiment. And my mother was also a minister in the provisional government. Now, this is funny because nowadays some people, I think they belong to the BJP, are claiming that Nehru was not the first prime minister. Netaji was the first prime minister. Well, in that case, Barkatullah Khan may be the first prime minister. These are all silly things, because these were provisional governments which were established outside the soil of India before independence, before India as we know it today existed. And it basically seems to me to try and, denigrate Nehru, which is also a foolish thing to do. Anyway, there was a provisional government of Azad Hind, and my mother was a minister in that. And then the Rani of Jhansi Regiment, of course, the training and going to the front. But as you know, the fortunes of war turned against the Japanese, and the Japanese surrendered. And the Indian National Army also had to surrender, and they had to face horrific conditions in their surrender, and they're trying to get back. Many, many people died in the kichar and in the rain and in the forests and due to disease. And the Ranis actually played a very heroic role in that surrender. And my mother was ultimately arrested by the British and kept first in Rangoon, then in Singapore. But she continued her medical work. And then finally, she was one day set free and brought by a plane to Calcutta and left in Calcutta. And then she came to Delhi because my grandmother was a member of the Constituent Assembly. And then she started campaigning along with the other INA people. My father and his colleagues had been released from the INA trial. That itself is a very historic moment. And actually, when you're talking about contribution to Indian independence, possibly that trial and the tremendous fervor that it created in the whole country, which was to the extent that the British didn't dare to either hang them or to sentence them to deportation or even put them in jail, because they said not a single English person would have been left alive in the country had that happened. So that was the kind of fervor that was created by the trial. And it is said that it was the first time the British realized that they could no longer rely on the loyalty of their army, and so they would have to leave. So that's another whole story. Anyway, they campaigned for the INA fund because the soldiers were in very bad condition, and also they campaigned incessantly for the unity of India, but that was not to be. So some people say, had the INA won, had Netaji come back, what would have been different? Well, maybe partition could have been averted, maybe, because of the huge enthusiasm that the INA would have garnered, even more it would have created. And maybe it could have been averted, but that we can't say. Anyway, partition happened, and my parents got married in Lahore just before that and came to Kanpur. Because my father was unemployable in British India, but he got a job here with a local industrialist, and so they moved to Kanpur. And they didn't celebrate 15th of August, but they decided to stay away from political parties, quite disillusioned. Though my father did contest the 1952 election, but he lost. And my mother started her work, and that's very important, because she started working in a clinic that was started for the refugees from Pakistan. That was in Nawamganj. And she worked there among the refugees, and she was also the only woman doctor who would treat Muslim patients, especially Muslim women in the Muslim areas. And she would go at night. She's a person who didn't know any fear. She would go at night or at any time. So in fact, most people over there say ki ye to pure mohalle abad kiye hain, Dr. Lakshmi ne. Anyway, so that was her attitude, and she could try to bring people together. And then later on, she wanted to join the government hospital, but she was over age, and she started her private practice. But everybody knows that it was never about money. It was never about earning or setting up a big hospital. It was always about service and serving the poor. And her commitment to her ideals. In 84, when there were very serious riots against the Sikhs, she actually stood with her alone in that Aryanagar gully in front of her dispensary, and she saved every single Sardar home and shop. Nobody came to any harm, and they all say that it was because of her. Nobody dared to flout her or to try and attack her when she was doing this. So that was the kind of person she was. She always fought for her ideals. She was actually very close to the communists even before independence, but because of their understanding of Bose, they didn't. My parents were not, you know, very sympathetic towards them. But then when I came back and joined the trade union movement, and someone called Comrade Ram Astre started visiting our home regularly, my parents were very impressed with him. He was a most wonderful man. And then Comrade EMS came here and stayed in our home. Jyoti Basu also came, Ram Murthy came, they would stay in our home. And my mother was actually keen. And then in 1971, when the Bangladesh issue became, and there were a lot of refugees, Comrade Jyoti Basu was Chief Minister of Bengal, and he called for help, medical help, and my mother went and ran a medical camp there. And she was very impressed by the devotion of the CPIM volunteers, and she thought she would join the party, but she had certain issues to clarify, so she went and met Jyoti Basu. And she said, well, I'm happy to join your party, but I want you to give a public statement saying that you can never think of Netaji as a traitor. You can never doubt his bona fides as a patriot. So Jyoti Basu thought about it, and he said, well, that is true. That is very true. We may have differences about the way he adopted. And he made a public statement in front of the press saying that this was a complete completely wrong notion, and we cannot doubt the patriotism of Subhash Chandra Bose. And then after that, my mother joined the party. And then, of course, she was very active in the women's movement, because the All India Democratic Women's Association was founded in 81, and she was one of the founders. So she went around the country campaigning for women. She was always very, very concerned about women's rights, women's health. She was the first doctor in Kanpur, anyway, to put up a sign इन फ्रंट ऑफ अ क्लिनिक विच सेट कि लड़का हो या लड़की इसका कारण माता नहीं पिता है. एंड लॉट ऑफ मैन यूज टू ऑब्जेक्ट बट शी यूज टू नेवर ऑल्सो ट्रीट फर्टिलिटी केसेज अनलेस द मैन ऑल्सो अग्रीड टू हैव अ मेडिकल एग्जामिनेशन. सो शी वॉज वेरी मच ऑफ अ फेमिनिस्ट इन हर ओन वे बट ऑल्सो शी वॉज कंसर्न अबाउट कास्ट. She was very much against caste. As a child of five, she had fought against untouchability in her own home, against her own grandmother, and seen to it that untouchability stopped being practiced in her family home in Kerala when she was 5 years old. So she had a very, very strong social and political consciousness, and she believed very much in equality. And when she contested as president, of course, she knew she was going to lose, but she said, we knew the INA was going to lose also. It doesn't matter. It's the battle that's important. And her campaign was very inspiring and quite amazing. And she continued to work and serve people till the day of her death. And I think that for a city like Kanpur, the kind of farewell that she received when there was no planning, nobody was asked to come, but the number of people who followed her body going to the medical college, they were also stunned that it was really being given to the medical college. Her eyes were also donated, and that has created actually a big movement for body, organ and eye donation all over India. It's every year on her death, many people sign up for this. So her life was very inspirational because it was a life of service, and it was a life dedicated to that is now very much under attack. So that is what I think we learned from her life.
Thank you for talking to us. Thank you.